take care of you, and he'll do it again. He'll do it again. If you just take a look at where you are now and where you've been, but hasn't he always come through for you? He's the same now as then. Oh, you may not know how, you may not know when, but he'll do it again. God knows the things you're going through, and he knows how you're hurting. You see, he knows just how your heart has been broken in two. But he's the God of the sun, the stars, and the sea, and he is your father. He can calm the storm, and he'll find a way to fix it for you. And he'll do it again. He'll do it again. If you just take a look at where you are now and where you've been, but hasn't he always come through for you? He's the same now as then. He's fighting for you. Oh, he's still God.
Oh, yes, he's still God.
And he will not change. Oh, I know that he's God.
Yes, he's still God.
And he's fighting for you. Oh, yes, just like Daniel. And just like Abednego, he'll do it again.
He'll do it again.
He'll do it again. If you just take a look at where you are now and where you've been, but hasn't he always come through? you just take a look at where you are now and where you've been. But hasn't he always come through for you? He's the same now as then. Oh, you may not know how, you may not know when, but he'll do it again. God knows the things you're going through, and he knows how you're hurting. You see, he knows just how your heart has been broken in two. But he's the God of the sun, the stars, and the sea. And he is your father. He can calm the storm, and he'll find a way to fix it for you. And he'll do it again.
He'll do the Lord it is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. He that believeth on the Son is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed on the name of the only begotten Son of God. Amen.
Get some mic here. There we go. Isn't God good? And all the time, God is indeed good. And that's why the psalmist could say, O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusted in him. And so even in death, God is good to the believer. And the psalmist again could say, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And so God cares deeply for his loved ones, even when we pass. Blessed then are the dead who die in the Lord. And so it's my joy and a pleasure to greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to welcome you to this praise and thanksgiving service for the wonderful life of our beloved brother in Christ, Carney Mac Henderson Cooper, and otherwise known as Mr. Debonair. And as I often refer to him at the chapel, the best dressed man at the chapel, the best dressed man in Freeport. And I think his wonderful wife, Ina, has something to do with that, even insisting that we be properly attired, boutonnieres and the likes of it. And so we bless the Lord for both Ina and Carney. And of course, our brother Carney was a faithful and committed member of the Freeport Gospel Chapel, and he used his gift of singing and worship to bless all of us at the chapel and those that he came into contact with. And yes, we will surely miss him. But we're here to celebrate his life, are we not? And to give God thanks for his testimony, one who loved the Lord and his family. And because we know he is with the Lord, we've not come here today to sorrow or to mourn as others who have no hope. For we are assured in Scripture that for the believer, say it with me, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, which is indeed far better. And we know, based on Brother Carney's profession of faith, that he is indeed with the Lord and his Savior, Jesus Christ. And so that knowledge indeed brings peace and comfort to our hearts, even as we worship, even as we praise God for his blessings today. And so we want to say to our dear Sister Ina and to Sammy and to Shanami, the grandchildren and the siblings, all of the extended family of our brother Carney, on behalf of the pastors and the deacons and the members of Freeport Gospel Chapel. And we also recognize, on behalf of the members and the leadership, the elders of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we express our condolences and we express our love, and be assured that we will continue to support and to pray for you, not just during your time of bereavement, but beyond. So after times, you know, during the weeks following the death, we're all actively, and then all of a sudden we disappear and we can't find one another anymore. But we will indeed be in touch and continue to be in prayer. So it's good to see you all. And we welcome you again to this service. And we again pray that we would be truly blessed. Now, when we conduct services like this, it turns into a gospel service, because Brother Carney would want us to bring the Word of God. He would want to ensure that those who are under the sound of the voice of the minister today would come to the saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so the gospel, the Word, is going to be preached this morning, this afternoon. So you use the morning funerals, right? But are you ready for that? Amen. And so we're going to invite you to stand. Of course, the family can remain seated as we turn in our booklet for our opening hymn, It Is Well With My Soul, one of our Brother Carney's favorite hymns. It is well. When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Let's stand if you can, please. shall be mine. For in death as in life, thou wilt whisper thy peace to my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. Be seated. And we pray that at the conclusion of this service that you too can truly say, like Brother Carney has said many times in his testimony, it is truly well with my soul. That's our desire and our prayer, even as the word comes forth today. We're going to invite our evangelist Philip Thompson to come with the invocation. And following the invocation would be a tribute from Pastor Rockland Bobbs. He's the chairman of the pastoral board at Freeport Gospel Chapel. And then we will have the first scripture reading from Psalm 121 from Antoinette Thompson, the niece, and a solo by Antoinette Kerr, followed by the various tributes from Pastor Peter Watson of the Northern Bahamas Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist, Pastor Shuffle Hepburn, and Elder Lawrence Palmer, also from the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist. And we would be asking again and reminding those persons bringing their various tributes to honor what has been requested of them to be as brief as possible, even as you reflect on the life of our dear brother, Carney. And so let's begin this package with the invocation from evangelist Philip Thompson.
Good morning. Let's bow our head and hearts. Dear God and Heavenly Father, we come before your exalted throne of grace. And we do so, dear God, in none other than the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you, dear God, for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your peace. Dear God, we reminisce at this time on the wonderful memories of our dear brother Carney. We thank you for his godly life. We thank you for his testimony. A father, a brother, a sibling, an uncle. We are filled with joy as we think of the wonderful memories of the times that we had with him. It is at times like this, dear God, that we are reminded that your word says that you are a God of all comfort, that you are able to comfort us during times like this when we're in trouble. And because of this comfort that you have given us, we are able to comfort others with the comfort by which we receive from God. We ask you, Heavenly Father, to just bless the family now. We think of our dear sister Ina, the children, and everybody. Undergird them, Heavenly Father. Sustain them. Be comfort to them at this time, and all friends and family and well-wishers. Have your way, dear God, in this service. Even as your word is opened, may we all be not just hearers, but doers. Again, we just ask your blessing on everything that would take place now. We do so in the exalted name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon again.
It was said of Carney that he was a delightful worker, quiet but purposeful. Carney is now in a new choir, that heavenly choir. His passion was always singing. He had a lot of practice down here at Freeport Gospel Chapel. Having been one of the original members of Freeport Gospel Choir, he was a member for over 50 years. And like I said, he's now in that heavenly choir. We will miss our brother Carney. Carney, I really love you, brother. We will all remember, those of us at Freeport Gospel Chapel, we will remember Carney for a special song. It was sung by his dear wife coming up here. He will do it again. And those of us at Freeport Gospel Chapel, whenever we need a miracle, or whenever we were reminded of a miracle, we would always refer to Connie's song. God, of course, being he, will do whatever we ask for again. And so we want to say now to the family, Aina, children, other relatives, we continue to pray for you, as was stated before. God will do it again. Whatever your request, whatever the prayer request, whatever the need, be assured that God would comfort you again, because his promise is to never leave you or never forsake you. And so we want to say from Freeport Gospel Chapel, from the pastors, oversight, and other members, please receive our heartfelt condolences of this time. And may God continue to bless you all.
Scripture reading is coming from the book of Psalms 121. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Good afternoon. I met Carney when I was probably 20 years old. I'm now 61, so that's a lot of years to spend time with someone sharing and caring. One of the things that came to my mind this morning about Carney was how kind he was. And I can recall after buying my home, he and Ina came to visit, and there wasn't a television in the guest bedroom. And he asked me why, and I said, I just bought this house, I don't have any more money. And Carney and Ina went out and bought a television for the guest bedroom. And those are things that Carney would do. I am happy to say how much I was loved by my brother in love. And I'm grateful for the life that he lived. He was a true Christian, a family man, a man full of love. Today, I think of how the burdens crush us down from time to time, and the disappointments come. We sigh, we get teary-eyed. But I'm looking forward to that day and to that world where pleasure reigns. There's not going to be any mourning there. So come with me, let's go to that land of peace and glory. We're going to go there someday.
If I am right, he'll fight my battle. I will have peace someday, life's journey will be yours. Jesus, he led me up. of angels as I lay my burdens down, down, down. Jesus, thank you, Jesus. He led me all the way.
Pastor Hartley Thompson, elders and ministers of Freeport Gospel Chapel, members of Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, members of the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Church, and all those who have come. Lay our dear friend, brother, family member to rest. I say good afternoon and happy Sabbath. Somebody ought to talk back to me. Happy Sabbath, everyone. I've been encouraged to spend just a few moments. And when someone would have impacted your life, you always have so much to say. You always have so much to remember. This is because God allowed that person to walk into your life, to carve you, to build your character somehow. And so when my wife and I were getting married, Sister Ina was our marriage coordinator. And we would have to go by the house from time to time. And I don't know, someone said it earlier, but Papa Carney, he would always look good. His skin so smooth, every hair in place. I admired him and I looked up to him to dress properly. Because when he walked into a room, although he spoke softly, he always had presence. You know he was there. Now forgive me, and you know you have to be careful when you say things like this in times like these, but he always smelled good. Now I'm a real man and he's a real man, but he always smelled good. And I know that he was a good person. And so today, we want to say thank you to the family for allowing him to impact our lives. Sister Ina, children, we loved him dearly. We know you love him too. And so I am not going to play theological gymnastics. The Bible lets me know that he's here resting, and we're going to lay him in the grave. But John chapter 14, 1-3 says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." The Bible says, Jesus said it, it's in red, in the Bible. "I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." So we look forward to that time. Amen? We have this hope. We want you to have this hope today. Our president of the North Bahamas Conference of Seventh-day Adventists wanted to be here today along with the administration, Pastor Burroughs, and our CFO, Sister Palmer, but they are in the Turks and Caicos Island taking care of some matters. But on behalf of them, my wife and I, all of the church members of the North Bahamas Conference, from West End in the South all the way to Sandy Point in Abaco, we love you, we're praying for you, and we know that God will keep you in the hallowed of his hands. May God bless you as you go through this time of sorrow.
Testing.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Reverend gentlemen, my brothers and sisters. I've been asked to give some remarks about Carney, my dear friend and cousin, our grandfather, Augustus Leopold Hepburn, fathered six children in Eleuthera, all of whom have the last name of Cooper, and Carney's dad was one of them. So Carney is our first cousin, and that's all I'm prepared to say about that. One way to discover the true character of a man is by doing business with him. As you all know, Carney was a realtor. A few years ago, I had a piece of property that I wanted to sell, and I called Carney, and he found a buyer in a hurry. And everything was going well until the closing. And everyone was paid except Carney and his partner. The purchaser turned around and refused to pay the commission which he had agreed upon in writing with Carney, and which was included in the sale price. He paid them nothing. I thought Carney would be very upset by this, but he did not allow his emotions to get out of control even a little bit. He took it very calmly. In fact, I was more angry and upset about this than Carney was. I called the buyer up, but got no satisfaction at all. And finally, I told Carney that I would go and see this person. I called a dear friend who is a born-again believer in Christ and asked him to accompany me to a meeting and be a witness for me, and he agreed. I told him he wouldn't have to fight. It was a very uncomfortable meeting. I told the venerable gentleman, in essence, that unless he paid the commissions, he would have two problems instead of one. Shortly thereafter, he paid the funds. You know, God's word says that a laborer is worthy of his hire. And Carney was a faithful man of God. And so God was faithful to him in all things. Carney was a God-fearing man who did not allow anything to ruffle his feather. He was honest, he was hardworking, he was trustworthy, but most of all, he was God-fearing. He was something that cannot be said about many of us. He was a decent human being. And when Carney became ill, I started praying for him and checking on him occasionally. As his illness became worse, I began calling him on Sundays to pray with him, read the scripture, and sometimes sing with my not-so-melodious voice. And sometimes when I called, he might be sleeping or having visitors, but he would always say, I would say, I'll call you back. No, he said, we could pray. Carney believed in the power of prayer. He really believed in the power of prayer. And Carney is not with us today, not because of a lack of prayer, but he's where he is today because of an abundance of prayer, for he was a prayer warrior. Like the Apostle Paul, he was hard pressed between the two, wanting to remain with them, but also having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. So he wanted to be with Ina and his family, but he also wanted to be with the Lord. And I'm believing, as we all believe, that the Lord has received him with a smile. Amen? May my wonderful friend and cousin rest in peace in Jesus' name. And everybody say, amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's really a privilege to have been asked to participate in this celebration of the life of a godly man. On behalf of the pastor of the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Church and our first elder, Sister Arlene Sands, Pastor Clark, and Elder Sands are, as mentioned, out of country, but if it were not so, they would have been here today. And so we offer condolences to the bereaved family on behalf of our pastor, first elder, officers, members of the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Church, located there on the corner of Gambia and Beachway Drive. We offer our condolences. I first became acquainted with Brother Carney way back when he worked at the perfumery distributor Betco many years ago. And then we became even further acquainted after he met and married Sister Ina. And also we were singers in the group called the Belcantos. I don't know if you remember that. But that was way back. And Carney always had a warm and gentle personality. He brought that personality and his musical gifts to bear everywhere he went. And it was one of the reasons that he was so loved at the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Church. He was, of course, the husband of Sister Ina, who was a stalwart member and who continues to serve. And as you know, as I look around, I see many members of our congregation here, the musicians, the deaconesses, they're all here because of this love connection. And so when Brother Carney was asked to sing at the Freeport Church, he always was willing. I can remember his beautiful duets with Sister Ina. We totally enjoyed them. Interaction with Carney also revealed that he was a godly man, a man of faith, and he had a personal relationship with his God. And it is because of the fact that I know he had this personal relationship with God that I come here not just offering condolences, but I offer you hope, the hope that comes from the Word of God. 1 Thessalonians 4, it says that the dead in Christ shall rise first. That is the hope that sustains us. It is also the hope that is given to us by Patriarch Job, who says, though the worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I will see God. And so we are looking forward to a reunification, a meeting in the air with Brother Carney, that if we prove faithful will take place, not as disembodied spirits, but as real people, flesh to flesh. And so, Sister Ina, may those words comfort you, provide you blessed hope. And until we meet again, I wish to reiterate what someone said earlier. God is going to do it again. God bless.
Amen. Thank you, brethren, for those tributes. Isn't it wonderful when someone's given a tribute and you know that every single word is true? And they're not up here trying to find words and trying to preach someone into heaven. Every single thing that they have said about our brother Carney is 100% absolutely true. And we say to God be the glory. But as these brethren were making their tributes, I thought, you know, behind every great man, there's a great woman, no? And so we got to give some tribute to our dear Sister Ina as well, because this is a woman of God. And this woman of God loved some Carney. And she demonstrated that day in and day out during his time of illness. She was there alongside. And when folks would come over, she would entertain, she would support, she would help, she would feed, she would provide. And so, dear Sister Ina, thank you for your love and for your care that you provided to our dear brother. I know you miss him terribly, but God is going to ease that pain. You know, joy cometh in the morning. And of course, to the children as well, they were there alongside. And to Jamie, it's good to see you. And of course, Sammy alongside, and Shanemi, all supporting and loving their papa and their pa, our brother Carney. So to God be the glory. We're going to invite you to stand once again now, and our family will continue to seat as we sing. I'll fly away. Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Now, if you feel like stomping and you feel like clapping, please do that, okay? You think Brother Carney has earned his wings? He has flown away into glory. Amen. Amen. This is a rhetorical question. Do you love Brother Carney? You know, those expressions out there, I need to see the love coming from you. Do you love Brother Carney? Amen, amen. I suppose, and I know by your presence here, it speaks volume of your love and your friendship for our Brother Carney and our dear sister, Ina. We love him. We miss him. But God, he's in God's hand and worshiping. Even as we are worshiping here, he's worshiping in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. To God be the glory. We're going to have some reflections by Elder Lewis Thurston, a family friend, and also Keith Henfield, a nephew. And then we'll have a second scripture reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 51, and 58 by Lana Cooper, who's a sister-in-law, and a musical selection from the Freeport Seventh-day Adventist Praise Team. And then, as I knew him, Benjamin Sands, a co-worker and friend, and our deacon, Joseph Young, his best friend. In that order, please. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all. It's really a sad occasion when you have to take time out to reflect on your knowledge of one who you have grown to love so much, who would have passed on. I have found Carney to be one who was pure, kind, and true. What do I mean by that? None of us can be on or swear, become any of those things in our present condition. But to the best of his ability, Carney lived up to all of those things that were said, and still some. Carney was a very pleasant person, one who always found it quite easy to smile. I have never seen him in a position where I could have said that he is angry. And I guess that shouldn't be the case. But however, I never saw him angry. He was not one of those who were anxious to give you a piece of his mind. He died with his mind intact. You know, because if you keep on giving everybody a piece of your mind, you'll be out of your mind. But, as has been mentioned a while ago, I would like to mention that about 4 years ago, I woke up very, very early one morning to watch the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan. And I was somewhat taken aback as I listened to a song that was rendered by a group of Meghan's friends. They were people like us. And they sang so beautifully a secular hymn made popular by a secular artist by the name of Benny King, "Stand By Me." And I thought of that and wondered why that song at that time. And as I thought about it, I realized only too well that when two persons come together and decide to have a wedding, see, the wedding and the marriage is not one and the same. You could be wedded and never married, as is the case of the vast majority of people who think they're married. You know, but the truth about it is that when we stand by each other and God is on our side, it's on our sides, nothing goes wrong that he can't make right. I cannot forget, it was about 22 years ago when Carney was first diagnosed with cancer. Anina went immediately into search mode, trying to find some medical center that would have had a history of caring for people beyond just the money, but having in mind to be able to help that person experience recovery. Of course, only God can heal. God can heal, because I remember I went to a doctor one time with my wife, and I just made a sarcastic comment, and he said, "Brother Thurston, you know, I do my best, but only God can heal." And Ina found a place all the way in California, a proton center, very far away. Carney went there, and he spent 8 weeks there. And for 6 of those weeks, Ina stayed there with him. She stood by him through thick and thin. But even when it got very thick, she didn't thin out. Thank you, Ina. And after 8 weeks, she brought Carney back. And you remember I said 22 years ago, Carney remained well, free of cancer, for about 22 years. It's a long time, eh? And during a time in and out of the hospital here, Ina stood with him. Stand by me. She vowed to do that, and that's what she did. And even where he died on the north, what you call it, the west coast of Florida. It's the west coast, right? Yeah, it's the west coast. That was a sort of journey of hope. But she stood by him. And even now that Carney is gone, we are still on our sojourn, because we are only pilgrims and strangers here. One of these days, each of us will have to give an account to God for our stewardship. But he was by his side up until the time that he died. And while it is true that you feel badly and, you know, and sad that someone as close as that moves on, you're satisfied when you have done the best that you can do. And you did that. But now, in conclusion, you know, when Ina told me the time that I should speak, I said to myself, but you know, usually I can say in conclusion and go on again. And then say, finally, and go on again. And then say just one more word before I close and go on again. But I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that because I understand the urgency of time. But I just want to say to you that while it is true that we need each other as spouse, we need each other. You needed him as much as he needed you. But there is one who we all need more than anyone else. And that one is Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. And one of these days, after a while, we will all have to account for how well we did or did not stand by him. Because we can't do anything to stop him from loving us. But we can do things to stop him from saving us. May God bless you.
Today I have mixed emotions, feeling privileged, feeling sad. Sad because I won't get to call or see my uncle Carney again. But at the same time, I feel privileged to be able to do this one last thing. When my aunt, Nina Ox, Betty yet told me I needed to do a tribute for my uncle, his passing became real to me. When I got the call from Shinemi that my Uncle Connie had passed, I felt numb. I started to reflect on one of my first memories of my Uncle Connie was my brother Kevin and I going by Uncle Connie for haircuts. Uncle Connie told us how we needed to brush and comb our hair. He told us if we comb our hair the right way, it would be trained and easier for him to cut. I thought getting a haircut was a simple process before that. That shows me no matter how simple something was to him, it had to be done right. He was a perfectionist. He was a jack of most trades. Anything he did it well. He was always shaven, neat, well-dressed, especially for church. I also remember my Uncle Connie picking Kevin and I and a few of our cousins to help him with inventory whilst working at Little Switzerland. Despite the fact that Kevin and I were a little mischievous, if it was me, knowing how troublesome we were, I wouldn't have picked us up to do inventory. That was another one of his good traits. He was never judgmental. Always accepted and loved us for who we were. No matter how much trouble we got in, we got into trouble. One of the first things he would say when he saw us back then was, "I hope y'all ain't getting no trouble." My Uncle Connie was a very soft-spoken, caring, easy to talk to, straight shooter. We had many conversations about life. I could always count on him, to be honest. Sometimes you don't want to hear honesty. But he never made me feel that because he was older or a Christian, my views didn't matter. I feel proud to know that if he wanted or needed something, needed anything, he knew he could call me. I didn't know that his last birthday, October 10th, would have been the last. But I'm grateful that I'll be able to spend it with him. Uncle Carney, I'm thankful for your love and time we shared. The many talks we had, your advice, and for being someone I could always count on. I have lost not only an uncle, but a friend, role model, advisor. You are gone, but you will never be forgotten. We may be apart, but your memory will live within me forever. First Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 and 14 says, I would not have you be arrogant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that we sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Christ, will God bring with him. May you forever rest in peace. May you forever rest in God's grace, Uncle God. This was hard.
Good afternoon, church. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. But this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of God is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brethren, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. There ends the reading of God's holy word, which is already blessed.
Amen.
With Happy Sabbath. My choice to actually speak on as I knew Carney. I know most people come to church just to hear about the individual, Phil. and they want to hear whatever you have to say. So I'm going to take a page out of the poet Mark Antony, that we're here to bury Carney today, not to praise him, for the evil that men do live after them, but the good tarries in the bones. So God knows everything. Carney and I became friends basically through my gathering with the church. I used to go to Batco where he worked to collect monies every year for the church, and he'd see to it that I get it. And I met him, Ina was living in Seahawks Village at the time. That was about 36 years ago. He was courting her at that time, and my wife and her go way back, because she sang at my wedding. Yeah. Yeah, when I got married in Nassau. Matter of fact, yesterday was my anniversary. 45 years. Phil? Keith? I should get a crown, eh? My wife also. Carney struck me right off the top as the kind of person that had that spirit of love and joy. And he was easy to get adjusted to. And then after he got married, I got a little closer because my wife went to the house. We went there together, back and forth. And we bonded in the relationship because, as you know, Ina is an Adventist and Carney is a Brethren. So I wondered about that because I needed to know how that was working out between the two of them. I know she was trying to bring him in the Adventist church, and he was still holding on to the door. He wasn't moving. But I said, boy, I need to talk with this man, but I don't know him that well to talk to him about that. But the Lord always set up things. You could find out things after a while. The Lord always put it in place. You know, I was in law enforcement for quite a while. I retired 10 years ago, and I established a company called Freeport Properties Real Estate, still existing today. A few years ago, Carney, while working with Thompson's Real Estate, and she died, he decided to join me at my company. And some things you never know until a funeral. Like today, I never know. Sheffield? they use a Cooper too, right? We related. Family Luthra. The same family. Phil? We were telco for years. We were one family. I'm just finding that out today. And as close as Carney and I was, he never talked about Eleuther. That's why we never got into that. But he loved chicken, Kentucky chicken. And I used to go home most of the time to, so you don't buy no Kentucky chicken and cook, because my wife managed my office, and, you know, they always send the husband home to cook. And I said to Carney, and this is coming from one of world-renowned neurologists, Dr. Evans out of Nassau, and he said, I said, Carney, Dr. Evans said, chicken is a major cause of prostate cancer. Well, that's a fact. I studied that up. That's the truth. So I put in the plug there. Check it. Carney was that kind of gentle person, patient, and he never really rap about anything. And that same deal Sheffield spoke about that we did through my company, Carney had the client, I had the buyer. So we brought them together, and yes, they didn't want to pay that commission. And you know, Carney just basically come in, so I wanted him to get his feet wet and get some of that money. And well, you know, I'm not going to let them get away with that. Not through that company. They're going to pay that commission. And there were some people that really, I never thought would have done something like that. So I had to call the bishop in Nassau, you know, put him on the spot. And they paid it. But one thing I noticed with Carney is that he loved all of his children. And he was never one that I ever knew about to go anywhere, to go out. And that's not him. It's home, work, church. That's all he did. And I said, boy, listen, I used to sometime when I get his commission, I'll take it. If he's home, I'll take it in cash. And sometimes it's a big roll, right? So I say, Carney, don't give Ina all this money. I say, you need to put a little something in your pocket for it. He say, no, man, see, she's paid the bill and all kind of things and the car and all this. I say, this man, see, I don't do that. I may give my wife some money, but she can get all my money. But that's all he wanted to do, to make her happy. I make my own happy without giving all the money. You know what I mean, Keith? So, but we develop a closer bond and a relationship. So now I needed to find out from Carney about this faith relationship. I know he had a good relationship, but a faith relationship. You down there and she up here. So what the deal is, what do you think about the Sabbath? And, you know, I had to ask that question. He said, man, meaning and it's worship every Sabbath, Friday evenings. I said, we have Sabbath worship. And he's telling me not what I shouldn't do on the Sabbath. I said, this man is the Sabbath keeper. But he wouldn't leave the brethren because he had a solid relationship with his brothers at the church. And he did a lot. He'd go up there and say, I have to go up to the church this weekend, do some painting and all that. He's not leaving them. But I could take a page from Carney's relationship with the brethren, because once a week, they got together as a crew of them, and they went for lunch. So sometime I would come, I'd go home, cook, and when I get back with the food, they'd say, Carney went to lunch with Churchill and those men. I said, that's right, this is the day that they, so I eat that lunch too. But Carney, we got real, real close. I'd call him all the time. You know, the only time Carney really called me, he called me to tell me he was going away. I said, I didn't expect that call. He said, I'm going tomorrow. I said, going tomorrow? He said, yeah, you know, going to the States in Academy. You're going to the States, that's what I mean. I said, well, okay, well, don't give up. He said, no, I ain't give up. I keep calling back to the States, because he always keep that cell phone right by the bed. When he was here sick and during the pandemic, Carney was hiding from COVID. He wouldn't come out. Hiding from COVID. And then he got sick and went to the RAN. A couple days later, he got COVID. I say, man, that's the safest place I thought would be. you're going to run to catch COVID. And two times, you know, they tell them the same thing. I think you better don't go there no more. Stay home. But Ina did everything that she could do with Connie to take care of him while he was sick, and I admire her for that. And you know, my wife, she's in ministry. She's not here. She's in Turks Island, like Elder Palmer told you. I'm on mission, and I always go with her. Now this was a long trip, and she Ina planned this funeral for today, the 3rd. And I said my anniversary was yesterday, and she left Thursday. She couldn't be here, and she wanted to, because every time I talk with Connie, instead he asking me how I doing. How's Eileen? Man, you mean how's Eileen? I'm the one you should be asking. She in charge. They always asking for her, and we enjoy that kind of relationship. So on behalf of my wife, family, and by extension Ina's family also, we want to give our heartfelt condolences. And I thank God for the life of Connie. He knew a lot of people, and they all respected him. And he was quiet. He was organized. Boy, that man could be organized. Man, listen here, he had everything. And had a microfine glass and all the way. I'm disorganized. So I leave everything in memory. And anytime I wanted to find out anything, I go to his office and said, ask for it. And he, right there, like he's not there, and I call him and ask him for something, he could point me right to the spot. Be of good cheer, Keith. This is not the last time you'll see him if you're faithful. Amen.
Good afternoon. As I knew him, today, despite my grief and pain on the loss of a dear friend and brother in Christ, it gives me great pleasure to speak on his behalf. Connie Cooper was small in stature, quiet, pleasant, resilient, and cordial to all. As a Christian, he made himself available to serve in all facets of his church, Freeport Gospel Chapel. He sang solos. He was a committed choir member. He mastered the grill during church picnics, and he had no problem in frying fish for Good Friday Fun Day. Whatever his hands found to do, he did it with all his might. Connie was quiet, soft-spoken, but this did not affect the impact he made. His contribution to the church were many. He was a debonair gentleman. He was always well-dressed. He was very particular about his appearance, and it showed. Connie made himself available, not only because he loved his church and the congregation, but because of his love for God. He took every opportunity when available to fellowship with the people of God. This fellowship led to a small group of us, including Connie, going for lunch on Wednesdays. It was during these times we got to share about our families and spoke about the goodness of God. Connie loved his wife, Ina. He spoke fondly of her and with great concern. Despite his failing health, he tried to make himself quiet, quite useful in the home, and even tried to keep the yard manicured through all his pain. He spoke well of his children in such a way no one could doubt his great appreciation of them. He loved his family dearly, until his failing health made it impossible to attend church services. Connie and I were the only tenors left in the choir. I felt so good standing and singing with such a songbird. He was greatly missed. He will be greatly missed the day he is free from all his pain and enjoying the presence of God. He is now resting in peace. Carney Cooper. C is for caring and compassion he displayed. A is for available. He was there every step of the way. R is for respect and reputation he has earned. N is for nuggets of wisdom so many of us can learn. E is for ever willing to give service to his sisters and brothers. Y is for his yearning to keep, to be kind and generous to others. C is for his concern and commitment in his church and family life. O is for openness he shared with his loving wife. O is for his obedient to follow God's will. P is for prayerful, whether he was healthy or he was ill. E is for excellent and elegant in all that he pursued. R is for reverence and high regard. We will always howl for you. Sleep on, my dear brother, sleep on and take your rest. Lay down your head upon the Savior's breast. We love you, we love thee well, but Jesus loved thee best. We bid you good night, and good night. Ina, I want to take a personally thank you for all you have done for Brother Carney through his illness. I know it was not an easy road, but you traveled that road and you came out on top. I love you, and God loves you best.
Amen. Thank you for those wonderful reflections. And as I knew him, this is Ian, I almost stood up, but I left that alone. He was jovial and brought some light to some of the affairs of himself and Brother Carney. This is the gentleman that Benjamin Sands. A lot of jokes there. I'm going to ask you to just stand and stretch yourselves for a moment. We're getting to the core of the program where, again, the gospel will be preached by our senior pastor, Hartley Thompson. So just stand, and where you are, let's just sing in our hearts. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, isn't there? That wonderful selection by the Seventh-day Adventist choir. That was awesome. Praise the Lord. Let's stand. Musicians, can you help us on this? There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And if you want to shake hands with someone or move a few feet just to say hello. You know, funerals are a time when you get to reunite. It's a reunion, so to speak. And as we do that as well, we will call the Freeport Gospel Chapel Choir to come. But there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face. And I know you feel the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Just before the choir bring their selection, we do want to acknowledge those who may have traveled from abroad to show your love and support for the family. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your love, your expression, your support for the clergy who are here today, and particularly for those who were sharing this podium, bringing their testimonies and assuring the family of God's favor upon them. And we do see some member of parliament here. We want to acknowledge again the Honorable Michael Pintard, who's the leader of the opposition and the MP for Marco City, and also J. Kwesi Thompson, the member of parliament for Pine Ridge. And so we East Grand Bahama. That's next for you, Crazy. But we thank the Lord for all of you who have come today to share in this praise and thanksgiving service for our dear brother Carney. And truly, we have been blessed by all of the testimonies, all of the songs that have been raised. And again, we look forward to the gospel even as it will be presented shortly. And so let's have the Freeport Gospel Chapel Choir. Of course, the obituary will be read in silence. And we will have a saxophone soloist from our brother Andrew Thompson and a musical tribute from our sister Ina, the wife. Jesus promised me a home over there.
Jesus was a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole.
Jesus was
Promise me.
Amen. God and God alone. One of Brother Carney's a favorite at the chapel. I want you to just stand, even as we introduce the man of God for the hour here. Going to bring the word to you. He's the senior pastor of Freeport Gospel Chapel. He's been preaching the word of God for more than 60 years. And we, indeed. And I let you in on a little secret as well. Just celebrated he along with my mother. So that means what? He's my father. 66 years of marriage. And I heard one brother, Benjamin, kind of did a Freudian slip there, you know? Talk about marriage and funeral and whatnot. But God has been good and gracious and kind and has blessed him for these many years, almost to be 87 years of age. And it's still a power pack when it comes to bringing the word of God. And so please put your hands together and welcome him now as he would come and speak to what God would lay upon his heart, even now. Test.
Thank you. Thank you, Randy. Firstborn. I greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and the Savior, Jesus Christ. And I can speak voluminously about Brother Carney. In fact, his entire family, all from East Street Gospel Chapel, but transferred down here, became a part of Freeport Gospel Chapel and from other chapels, and his family in particular, starting with his great-grandmother, were all a part of our church, and most of them still are. And so I sometimes think maybe I should claim all the people from Ragged Island, because they love the brethren, and the brethren love them. Now, this is a kind of ecumenical service in a way. Carney was a part of Freeport Gospel Chapel for practically all of his converted life. And of course, we are blessed to have the Seventh-day Adventist with us performing and sharing in this service. And this edifice that we are in was built and is led by a bishop who calls me Dad, and my precious wife, Maria, he calls Mom. And we are in constant contact. And so we have the brethren here, we have the Adventists here, we have some of the Baptists here, and I'm sure there are many other groups that are represented. And so that's why I said we are a kind of ecumenical service. Now, the last time I was privileged to speak here at a funeral, the preliminaries run so late that I decided I would just use an introduction to the sermon. So this time, we're confronted with a similar situation. So what I'm going to do is give you the last half of that message I preached the last time. That's okay? All right. We don't want to tire you. As a matter of fact, some of you may not know that according to our laws, funerals are only allowed to go a certain time. In fact, you can't conduct a service after 8 o'clock, not even in the church. You can't bury a body after 8 o'clock. You can't perform a wedding before 7 o'clock. These are all in our laws, but who follows any laws today? We just do what we think comes natural. And so I am a stickler for time. I know you are somewhat weary after all the many reports and singing and everything else. Although we were praising the Lord, we are humans and we get weary. So I'm just going to bring you the last part, the second half of that sermon, and then you will be free to do whatever follows. But I will not be charged with keeping you long. Thank you. The history of the Christian. Four words we are going to use to emphasize the importance of this outline. The Apostle Paul, who authored most of the New Testament books under the direction of the Holy Spirit, was not always a spirit-filled Christian. His life, Saul, started as a sinner. And it is also true that every Christian was at some time before their conversion a sinner. Now, I know we all like to believe that we were born Christians the first time, but that's not the truth. To become a Christian, you have to be born again. It's not by a natural birth. It is a spiritual birth. And so the first thing we want to stress is the importance of realizing the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. As by one man, sin entered the world, and death by sin. And so death is passed upon all, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are sinners by nature. We have an Adamic nature. And before our conversion, we are identified in Scripture as sinners who have fallen short of the mark that God has set for mankind. But not only are we sinners by nature, but we are all sinners by practice. For who among us in this wonderful congregation would have the tenacity to stand and say, I have never sinned? No one would dare in their right mind say that they have never sinned. Although our sinning should have been confined to our unconverted days. So before we come to Christ, we sinned. The Bible tells us what sin is, just in case some of you have any doubt. Sin is going contrary to what God says. Sin is a transgression of the law. To him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And so all of the things that came from our depraved nature because of the fall of Adam has placed us in God's book as sinners. And therefore, Paul confessed that before he came to know Christ personally as Savior and Lord, that he was in fact without Christ. Now it is my hope and wish and prayer that all of us seated here this afternoon have come to know Christ as our personal Savior. But to make my point in this brief outline, before a person is saved, before their sins are forgiven, we were all sinners. And so we come to understand then that at that time, that past time, because there's a difference between being saved or a Christian or converted or redeemed, all that history is attached to our past prior to our conversion, our repentance, and trusting Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. And so he was without Christ, and so were we before our conversion. Secondly, you know how the Apostle Paul got converted on the road to Damascus, going to persecute churches and believers because they regarded that anyone who said anything that was contrary to Judaism was not worthy of life. And so he joined that group as an unconverted person who was without Christ. He tried to join in the massacre of believers and sought to exterminate them from the earth. All of that, however, was when he was without Christ. But then, on the Damascus road, he met Jesus Christ. He was gloriously converted. That is, he passed from spiritual death unto spiritual life. He was born again during that time on the Damascus road when he came to know Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. The Lord spoke to him, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And Saul wanted to know, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord responded, "I am Jesus whom thou persecuted." That was his conversion experience. He acknowledged that Jesus Christ was Lord when the revelation came to the inner recesses of his heart. He realized for the first time he was not only a religious man, but he was a converted man. He knew Jesus Christ. And so he passed from that stage of being without Christ, and now he found himself in Christ. And the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation." Can you believe this? God, through the work of the Holy Spirit, takes a sinner, regardless of his status in life, converts that sinner, brings him into the glorious liberty of the gospel of Jesus Christ through the preaching and application of the Word of God. Because Paul experienced conversion, which is really a change of heart towards God, a right about turn. As I stated, there is none righteous, no, not one, not of himself or herself. All of our self-righteousness is as filthy rags before God. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, "You must be born again. And except a man be born again, he cannot see or enter into the kingdom of God." So conversion is a new experience which brings us into Christ. And Paul entered into the personal relationship with Jesus Christ when he was converted. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things, meaning the old life, the life of Adam that was permeating our being, all of that is history because we have been born again, born through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that was shed for us upon the cross. And so when we have had that conversion experience, we, like Paul, can be said to be in Christ now. We are in Christ. And somebody once asked, how can a person be in Christ? Well, it's by the application of the Holy Spirit in the heart after one repents. You know, you can be in a in the sea, and the water can be in you. And so the reality is the Lord Jesus Christ puts us into himself. We belong to Jesus after we are converted to him. And then thirdly, the Apostle Paul instructs us as new believers or as believers in Christ, he says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. Every believer in Christ, every converted person is supposed to be an ambassador for Christ. That is, an ambassador represents his country in another country, in a foreign land, for instance. And so when we come to Christ, he makes us ambassadors. We have the responsibility of sharing the gospel, witnessing for Jesus. We are to let the world know that we have passed from darkness into light, and we have no greater desire than to see the unsaved, the unconverted, come to Jesus Christ so that they can be cleansed and be taken out of darkness into God's marvelous light and become ambassadors for Christ. That is what Brother Carney experienced. He became a new creation when he was saved, a new person. And then he became an ambassador when he realized that he was in Christ. And so he witnessed for Christ. He was kind to people because of what Christ was doing in him by the Holy Spirit. He gave of himself, and he was very, very helpful to so many people. He had a new song that he could sing because of the joy of the Lord that permeated his being. And he sang with such wonderful melody and praise to God who called him out of darkness into his marvelous light. So we note first that Paul and all of us who are saved, there was a time when we were without Christ. And then when we got saved, we were brought in to Christ. And then because we were saved, we wanted to see or still want to witness for him. We have a responsibility, you know. When Jesus told his disciples to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, that commission was given to every believer. It's not just a chosen few. Yes, we have different gifts and abilities, but the reality is all of us are called to be witnesses. You shall be my witnesses, saith the Lord. And so let's get on the job. Let's identify ourselves with Christ and let the world know that we are on the Lord's side and that he has commissioned us to share his living word. Because you see, the word of the Lord abided forever, and we are to share it. Because I can tell you right now, if I had the time to delve into prophecy, which I will not do now because I've already given you a promise. Some of you might have heard a young evangelist, Philip Thompson, on radio talking about the four horses of the revelation that God gave to John regarding the signs of the times, etc., etc. And Paul adds, this know ye in the last days, perilous times shall come. So this is the age in which we are living. And we know that when we see these things begin to come to pass, we are to lift up our hearts and heads because our bodily redemption draws nigh. And so Paul recognized that he was an ambassador, and so should we. Don't be ashamed to tell your friends about Jesus. Let them see that you are different, you're changed now, and you want them to have that same wonderful experience so that they too can relate to and identify with those of like precious faith. And the fourth thing that we want to share from Philippians 1:23, it was quoted here earlier. Excuse me. Paul said to the church at Philippi, he says, I am in a strait between two. I have this struggle, this inner struggle, because I really want to live so that I could continue to be an instrument of blessing in the church. I want to live so I can demonstrate to you the reality of a converted life. And he was a teacher, he was a preacher, he had ability to heal as God gave him that gift likewise. He visited the sick, he was sympathetic and caring towards fellow believers, and he was a man of great tenacity. He suffered intensely and immensely for the sake of Jesus Christ. And he said, all of these things, none of those things move me, because he realized that he was an ambassador and he was called to suffer for Christ in order that his life might emulate the Lord Jesus Christ. So he wanted to be with the saints. And, you know, I get that feeling sometimes that you really, you know, as my son said, I'll be 87 soon. But the reality is, while I have a gift from the Lord, which I've been using now for 70 plus years as a full-time minister of the gospel, but the reality is, I really would like to see the church, every church that names the name of Jesus, I would like to see the church so warmed about Christ, so on fire for Christ, that the outsiders will wonder about our devotion to the Lord. Paul said, I want to be here for as long as I can to teach you from Genesis to Revelation. This is the revelation of God. Don't add to the word. Don't take away from the word. Preach the word, he said to Timothy. Be instant, in season, and out of season. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. And so he wanted to stay so he could share with them the word. And so the Apostle Paul said, I have this double desire to live longer so I could inspire you and strengthen you as together we study the word and as we digest it and as we allow it to influence us positively for Jesus Christ. The second part of his burden was, I really struggling with going to be with the Lord, which is far better. Now, as much as we all desire or should desire to live, to be an instrument in the hand of God for the development and the growth of believers in Jesus, yet we know from what the word of God teaches that his coming is nigh. So Paul is attaching those two burdens that he has. And he says, I want to go with the Lord, which is far better. Oh, I tell you, the world is in such a state. Individuals are frustrated, confused. Sins are being committed on every hand. There's no regard, there's lawlessness. Parents and children are separated, husbands and wives going their own way. The nations are in great distress. There are wars and rumors of wars, and all kind of sinister things are happening, which were predicted in Scripture. This know ye, in the last days perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of themselves, covetous, boasters, heady, high-minded. They will have a form of godliness, but they will deny the power thereof. From such turn away. He says, your mission is to be an ambassador for Christ. You have to be exercised about the growth and development of the work of God. But alongside that, you must be always looking up, anticipating the coming of the Lord Jesus, which is even at the door. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And John, in closing out that wonderful revelation, used this beautiful benediction. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Oh, that should be the desire of each and every heart. We're going to see him face to face, and we're going to be like him. He will change our vile bodies and fashion them like unto his own glorified body. And throughout the countless ages of eternity, we will be praising him and adoring him because of the great work that he has done in us and through us for his own praise and glory. And guess what? All the struggles you are enduring now, if you are enduring them for the Lord's sake, he says he will reward everyone according as their work should be. So our labors are not in vain in the Lord. So press on, press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I see him down for a prayer after the next person. And so I'll hold the prayer until that is done. And when I'm invited back to pray, I will commend you all to the Lord in prayer. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you for that powerful word. You know, I would often end such a sermon in such an occasion as this to ask us to bow our heads and to sing that little chorus that some of us would have sung in Sunday school and would have known from when we were youngsters. Into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, come in today and come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. And as we have been told, to know that you firstly are a sinner and cannot save yourself, and to know then that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died on that cross for your sins, and that he is coming again, and he says, behold, I come quickly. And it's not of any good works that you may have done in the past or how much you may have given to the church. It's that personal relationship of acknowledging that you are the sinner and coming to know Christ, whom to know is life eternal. So even as you sing this little chorus, if you truly believe it, if you truly trust the Lord, he will come into your heart and he will cleanse you. And he says, behold, now I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hear my voice and will open that door, he will come in. He gives us that assurance. So into my heart, close your eyes and just meditate on those words for a moment. Into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Into my heart, into my heart, come.
Jesus.
we're in this solemn moment, we're going to call Senior Pastor to come back once again and to pray over us and to ask God's blessing again upon the family, to ask for his comfort and his peace for our dear sister Ina, for Jamie and for Sammy, for Shanemi, and for all of the family members, siblings, grandchildren, the likes of them all. Come and pray, and then we'll ask then for the vote of thanks to be given by Shanemi Swan.
Let us pray. Father, we are overwhelmed with a deep sense of your presence, power, and peace. We thank you for the truths of your word, that all have sinned and come short of your glory. We bless you too, dear Father, that through the hearing of the gospel, for faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, by the hearing of faith, we have repented, many of us, and have trusted Christ, and now we are in Christ. And Lord, we struggle with the battle over trying to edify and be a blessing in the church and the churches, and the imminent return of Christ. But on this occasion, Lord, we bring especially those that are mourning, those that are sad, those that are downcast. And we hear your word saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. And so we pray that the anointing and the comfort of your word and your Holy Spirit and the friendship that we share one with another, both as believers and as friends, will be realized through your divine endowment. May everyone in this sanctuary and others, dear Lord, that are not here but are related to Carney in one way or another, we pray your undergirding. We pray that you would envelop them in your love and grace and mercy, and let them know that you will never leave them nor forsake them, because your promises, I will be with you always, even unto the end of the age. A special prayer is asked on behalf of Sister Ina. We know of her diligence, of her devotion, of her love for her husband, and we realize the loss can be very, very, very painful, but you are there to lift her up, to garrison her heart by your faith. And so we pray that you would bless her and all the family members. We cast all of these concerns before you in the knowledge that you are a God who cannot fail. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so we rejoice in that knowledge as we give you thanks in our Savior's precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Shanemi, can you come now with the word of thanks, please?
On your left.
There you go. Thank you. Like mama, like daughter.
First, I would like to thank God for the life of my dad, Carney McHenderson Kapoor. I know at some point in life, we all must face this road, but this one was a
hard pill to take. But on behalf of my mom and my brothers, we would like to thank our family and friends and church families for their prayers, their love and support. There are many of you that are here, but some of you that could not make it and may be watching online, we just want you to know that we are grateful. We would also like to thank the medical teams that were instrumental in his care and giving him the answers he needed as he approached the end of his life. In that time, I think he did that more for what he went through. He did more for my mom, my brothers, and I, so that we could have peace in knowing that we did everything possible. My dad's touched so many lives, and we are receiving the benefits of the kindness that he showed others. So thank you at times does not seem adequate. But the Cooper family appreciates every kindness that has been shown to us throughout the years and now at this time of sorrow. So we just wanted to say thank you. And in my dad's, one of his last words to me, to see him again, he said, hold on to God. So I advise each of you here, I know it's unsolicited, which is something that he never did, so whenever he gave advice unsolicited, you listened. Hold on to God. If you want to see your husband, my dad, your uncle, your brother, your grandfather again, hold on to God. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to invite you to stand now as we bring this service to a close. And we would ask, please, if you would remain standing while the family would lead the procession, followed by those who are on the podium. And let's now stand and sing this hymn, When We All Get to Heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll shout and sing the victory.